and beyond, and in the past. This morning, we want to just keep our bereaved families in mind, Brother Doug Richardson and Sister the Medley family, and any of those that have experienced bereavement in their families. This morning, we would like to please stand, and we're going to just open up with a little bit of worship this morning, because God has been so good to us. Hallelujah. We owe him all the praise this morning. So yesterday I was just telling Pastor in the study that when I got up, I pushed my window up yesterday morning. It was so cool. And I'm thankful for the cool weather. How many are thankful for the cool morning? When I pushed my window up and I heard all this crunching and crackling in the woods behind me, and I thought, man, there's some active squirrels in the woods. But it was too much crunching. And I kept standing there, and I looked out, and lo and behold, it was a whole family of deer. It was a doe, two fawn, and a buck with the horns and everything. So I took my camera out, and I was videoing, and I was dead awe at the beauty of those animals. And so this morning, I asked the Lord, I said, please give me a worship song, because I've had two in mind, and I just couldn't think of one. And the Lord spoke to my mind. He said, you saw those deer yesterday. They were there for a reason. And so I kept hearing Pastor Wood's song, that song that he likes to sing about as the deer panic for the water. And that's going to be our worship song this morning. And that's going to be our heart cry this morning. It's to pan after the Lord, just like a deer would pan after some water. So that's what we're going to sing this morning. And I just want you to just clear your mind, clear your heart, focus in on the goodness of the Lord. And we're going to sing this little song together. Let's be quiet before the Lord.
As the deer panted for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship.
As the deer?
As a deer panted for the water, so my soul longeth after thee.
You alone are my heart's desire.
You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship.
As the deer panted for the water.
As the deer panted for the water.
So my soul longeth after thee.
Longeth after thee.
You alone are my heart's desire.
You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you I give my spirit. You alone are my heart's desire, and I to worship thee.
As the deer?
As the deer panted for the water, so my song longeth after thee.
You alone are my heart's desire.
You alone are my heart's desire, and I
Lord, I praise you this this morning because of who you are, the creator of all good things. You've given us life, health, and strength, and you've given us every chance and everything to be back in a relationship with you. So, Father, who are we to turn you away? Father God, we just ask blessings upon this service this morning. I pray, Heavenly Father, that hearts will be open, that ears will be open to your word and to your calling and to your pleading, Heavenly Father. I pray right now those that are down and heavy laden will be lifted up in their spirits this morning from the word that will go forward. I thank you, Lord, for the people that are here because they're here for a reason, Lord God. And if they're not here for any good reason, Lord God, you can chase them down and open up their hearts and let them see you. So that's my cry for this day, Heavenly Father, that we see you in the splendor and in the glory during this service. We ask, Heavenly Father, that everything that we do is pleasing in your sight, Lord. We ask for forgiveness of all of our sins, Heavenly Father. We ask that you just overlook our shortcomings, Heavenly Father. Just lift up, we just want to lift up the name of Jesus in this place right now. Those that are just distressed out to no end, Lord God, lift that heavy burden from their hearts and from their minds. Lord God, will you deliver and set free this morning? And as we go forward in this service, Lord God, let us go out into the community and into our job places, Lord, and rejoice because of you and tell someone else who you are and what they must do to be saved. Lord God, we just commit this service unto you, Lord God. Even the word that's going forward, will you touch Pastor Woods and just help him to open up and just explain the word plainly so we can all hear, understand, and obey. Lord God, will you just take this prayer and just answer it the way you will see fit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And because Jesus is alive today, we do have a blessed assurance. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Hallelujah. And so our gospel choir is before us on this fifth Sunday. I would like for those that have your hymnals to turn to page 27. And we're going to sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. You can make this a personal thing this morning if you want to. Jesus is mine.
Yeah.
Attention, focus on praising and worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
In the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment of promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou may live long on the earth. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and in the admonition of the Lord. Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters, according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of heart of your heart, as unto Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servant of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will, doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatsoever good thing that any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bound or free. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven. Neither is there respect of person with him. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I think we need to read a little more. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and on your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints, and for me that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. May the Lord add blessings to the reading of his word.
Amen.
Is a movie coming out called War Crime? War Room. And at a time like this, we need to already have set up our war room, and our war cry should be hallelujah and amen. Because we are in warfare every single day. But we know that in the end, we Christians win. Amen. Thank you so much, Mother, for giving us that scripture in Ephesians. This morning, our morning announcements are going to be given by our own pastor. He said he loves doing this, so we shall let him do that today. This morning, our giving scripture comes from the book of 2 Corinthians in the New Testament, chapter 9 and verse 7. And I will be reading it from the NIV version. Our giving scripture says, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And I do realize that you may not have money to give, but you also have your health and strength and time. You can call someone up and give them some hello shouts out on the phone. Give in any way you can. Whatever you do, don't do it because you feel like you have to do it. God loves a cheerful giver. That means that your heart is open and flowing to give and also to receive. So if you look at my hand is tight like a fist. I cannot receive anything like this, but if I open my hand to receive, I can also open it to give. So today, ask the Lord, what is it that I should give to the building of his kingdom right here on earth? And give it cheerfully. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy and all-wise God, our Heavenly Father, we stand before you, Lord God, just standing in the need, first of all, of prayer. We love you, Heavenly Father. We thank you that you gave Jesus Christ to us so that we could come to him and love him and accept him for our salvation. Lord God, we just ask blessings upon each person that willingly and happily gives unto your kingdom right here on earth. And we ask, Heavenly Father, that in this church right here, that you just touch the hearts and minds of all the people that have anything to do with the finances and the furthering of your kingdom. Just bless each one by one. And even if someone doesn't have anything to give, Lord, give them the desire to just shout out hallelujah in Jesus' name. For we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
I know the blood still works. Such a high, energetic song, because you know what? Our God is not a dead God. He's a living and a real God. And he's moving all the time, even as we speak. Moving right now. Now, I mentioned that movie, War Room. I want you to know the ladies in the white, red hand, all the ladies in cream, white, missionary ladies, ladies who can go to the throne room of God in prayer and get a prayer through. If anyone in this church and under the sound of my voice needs prayer, an individual prayer and a touch, wave your hands, ladies. And go to one of these missionary ladies on this fifth Sunday or beyond and ask for prayer. And right now we're going to ask that Sister Carletta Dudley come and give us our moments of meditation. On the back of the program, there are plenty of names back there of people that need prayer. I need prayer. We need prayer. The whole world needs prayer because we're talking to our God who is a living and a moving God. So let us pray as she prays.
Garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet. The birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Father of compassion and God of all grace, we live each day in wide open amazement that the keeper of the universe knows our name, hears our voice, and cares for us. Father, as you have upheld your children throughout the ages, we are thankful to face each day knowing that we will not face it alone. Father, thank you. Thank you that you are more stable than the ground on which we stand, more enduring than the mountain peaks we admire, more consistent than the waves upon the ocean. Father, you are my hope, my strength, my everything. Father, your love and grace have not only given us hope, but have made us your children. Help us live with new vigor and confidence, knowing that Satan cannot have us and death cannot claim us because we are yours. Father, I apologize and I ask your forgiveness for everything I have done and every word I have spoken that has hurt someone in your family. Father, please bless our efforts as we seek less of our will and more of your glory. Lord Jesus, when you came among us, you proclaimed the kingdom of God in villages, towns, and lonely places. Father, we pray that your power and presence be known throughout this land. God bless America. Send us honest and able leaders. In times of prosperity, fill our hearts with thanksgiving. And in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in you to fail. Almighty God, guide the nations of this world into the way of truth and justice, and establish among them that peace which is the fruit of righteousness. For the poor and neglected, the homeless and the destitute, the aged and the sick, those who suffer for righteousness' sake, those who have none to care for them at all, who are so very, very dear to us, Father, we ask for spirits to reign, strength for the daily task, and courage to face the road ahead. Almighty God, we pray for this body of believers called Ebenezer, our dear, dear pastor and his family, those who mourn the loss of a loved one and all assembled here this morning. Father, fill our hearts with the peace that comes from knowing and trusting in your word. Father, on this fifth Sunday, we long for the outbreak of the joy of salvation we see in the book of Acts. We pray for your spirit to lead us into another era of outreach, conversion, and celebration. Now the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. Do not be afraid to speak. Do not keep silent, for I am with you. Father, give us wisdom to say things that lead people close to you. Give us words of hope and help for the broken, words of tenderness for the fainting, words of direction for the confused.
Father, my most fervent prayer this morning is for those who have walked away from the faith of their mothers and fathers. Father, hear our prayer. Bring our straying children home. For unto you, O Lord, I lift up my soul, for you are able and ready to forgive and abundant in mercy to all those who call upon your name. In the precious, precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, Savior, Redeemer, and Friend, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. for that testimony and song. It was your presence that changed us and delivered us and set us free. And for that, we are so grateful. Now, Father, I pray for those who may be here today that don't know you. Would you help them to believe in their heart and confess with their mouth that Jesus Christ, your Son, is Lord. And Father, you have raised them from the dead. Let them know they will be saved. Again, let them experience that grace of you, Lord, that gift of salvation. Now, Lord, as we approach your word, we do it carefully. You know my hang-ups, my inabilities, my sins, and I ask you to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Therefore, Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. We sense your presence here, so we ask you, Holy Spirit, would you teach us? Would you guide us? Would you lead us into all truth? Make this word so plain, so easy to be understood, that even a small child can be transformed to be like you. Lord, I ask you yet again, would you be in my eyes and my seeing, my mouth and my speaking, my heart and my understanding? Would you make my tongue that of a ready writer? Lord, we need your anointing to not only speak to our exterior, but we need it to get to that tender part of us, the interior, our soul, our very being, where all permanent change takes place. Help us to hear and to do your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are you ready for God's word today? We ask you to grab those Bibles, please, and open them to the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 5. We have been born through the scriptures as we've been led of the Lord, and we've been in the book of Peter for a bit. And we'll be finishing up 1 Peter today in that fifth chapter. And then on next Sunday, prayerfully, we'll be going into 2 Peter. Continue on with the saga the Word of God has dealt with in Peter's life, the Holy Spirit using him. So 1 Peter chapter 5, I want you to go to a very powerful verse today, 10. 1 Peter chapter 5 and 10. I want to give you an update on the a young gentleman, his blood pressure had failed, and they got him stabilized, so it's looking good. So thank you for your prayers. Just continue to lift him up and his family, that he can be encouraged today. 1 Peter chapter 5 and 10. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. Verse 10 again. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. I want to speak from the subject today, the God of all grace. The God of all grace. As we enter into this last chapter of Peter, it's been a journey. Remember, the time frame that we were dealing with was about AD 68. The setting or the context is that the church is going through, in just a few years, we're going to find out that Peter is actually going to be crucified. In AD 68, actually, it's believed by most theologians that Peter was crucified upside down, all for the gospel's sake. In this time period, looking at 63 to 64, in Rome or Babylonian area, the church is going through. There's a wicked king that wants to kill Christians, and all kinds of laws are being put on to actually be against the Christians, those who are saved and loving the Lord. We dealt with the fact that as a Christian going through in a society that's against them, oftentimes there would be doubt, is this the right way? Some of them who got saved out of their old life and came into the new life, they had thoughts, maybe it was better to be in the old life, at least I was accepted by family and friends. But now that they are on Jesus' side, it seems like their whole life is falling apart. But Peter wants to encourage them that God is still faithful in spite of our outward circumstances. today in this fifth chapter, Peter becomes very personal. He goes back to his thought pattern of when he was a disciple under Christ, and as he walked with Christ, he touched Christ. And Peter was very outspoken. Oftentimes, he would speak before he thought. There's some witnesses of some people in the house today that have spoken before you thought. And many times when that happens, all kinds of problems take place. So Peter wants to assure the people or the flock that's going through that the leaders are knowing what to do. They're knowing how to lead them under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Look at that first verse. The elders who are among you, I exhort. I, who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. He goes to this point as the church is suffering and goes through. He wants to encourage the elders. Now, the elders in a general term is just those who are older in the church, who have been sanctified in the faith or separated, walking with the Lord that you can look up to and that are living the life that Christ has betrayed before them. He talks to them and he says, I am an elder also. I picked up some age. I think that he had a sense that he would be dying in just a few years. And therefore, he says, I've been here. I am a fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ. Peter was there, and we'll talk about that a little later. He was there and saw the beatings of Christ, the anointed one. He was there in all the stresses of life. He was there in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus prayed those three times and sweat as drops of blood permeated from his pores. He said, I witnessed the sufferings of Christ and also am a partaker of the glory that be revealed. He makes a subtle statement here. He's saying, through the sufferings, I'm also going to come to a point of being to partake in the glory of God. This is very important. What he's saying in another sense, when we go through, there's a good side on the other side of through. When we're suffering in our lives, there's a good side because our suffering will not last always. I'm talking to the Christians in the house. The God of all grace. He says, I'm a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Just to encourage you, wherever you're at right now, you may be struggling with jobs, struggling with bodies, struggling with things of the mind. Please note this, that God's glory is going to be revealed. The glory, as we explained earlier as we went through Peter, is the shining of God. This is the very presence of God in our lives that when we come to the end of ourselves, we can sense the Spirit of the Lord. Some of you have been there. You didn't have any more strength. You couldn't push anymore. But then the anointing that came into your life and then God shining or his glory was revealed, verse 2. And he uses this capitalized. He says, shepherd the flock of God, which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly. Now he gives us a definition of good leadership within the body and the fellowship, because even in today's time, we've got a lot of bad leadership that's been set up. He says, shepherd the flock. The shepherd looks over the flock. He cares about the flock, but he makes a statement. This is very important. If you hear, we've got different people from different denominations and churches. He says, shepherd the flock of God, which is among you. I must tell you today, I'm excited to be here as a pastor, as an elder in the church, but you're not mine. You are the flock of God. How do I know that? Because I'm a sheep also within that flock. We have varying gifts that God has put before us, but we can never forget that we are a part of God. Thank you for lifting up our elders, praying for our pastors and our ministers. But the first thing, you got to understand that God is your leader. Look at this. Shepherd the flock of God, which is among you. And we as leaders need to serve, not as among you serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly. Do you know that some people in their serving and their capacity, they hate serving people. They hate doing what they do. But Peter says, you've got to know that you've been saved first, you've been delivered and set free, and you don't lead because people are pressuring you, but you lead because you're willing to do what God has called you to do. Isn't that a struggle even in the church today, that leadership has become hard to find, that sometimes people are ordered to be in leadership when they don't have the grace and mercy of God moving in their heart? You ever seen a usher that's been compelled to usher? Oh, I pray you didn't see any today, because we had some young people that didn't know they were supposed to usher, and you may have saw it on their face. They were ushering under compulsion. They were planning on just sitting in the pew and having a day off, but when they got here, some things got mixed up, so they stood, and if you carefully looked at them, what they were saying in their face, can we get this on so the pastor can stand up and I can sit down? Don't you feel that sometimes when you're in a church amongst leaders, deacons, and pastors, that they feel compulsion, they're not willingly giving you, and simply because Peter makes this not for dishonest gain, but eagerly. Maybe the compulsion comes because some folks don't want to preach or teach or lead just because God is moving in their heart, but they're doing it all for a paycheck. They're doing it all to be clapped for. They're doing it all to be slapped on the back. They're doing it all for all the extra stuff. That means it's for dishonest gain. Could that be the attack upon the church today, that there are leaders that are in it for just the money? Did you know that in some churches we've come to the point that praise teams won't sing unless they get paid? Did you know we're in a day and time that some of the greatest choirs that you've heard, they get paid to sing, and if they don't get a check, they don't sing? Did you know that in the church, this is an epidemic that's coming? I'm not speaking against the paying per se or the honorariums, but what I am saying, if the only reason you do what you do to get a paycheck, you're missing that. I'm talking about the God of all grace. If the only reason you're here today is because you're going to get some fringe benefits of somebody saying you did a good job of coming to church today, you missed it today. He said, for not for dishonest gain, but eagerly. That means that there should be something that's on the inside that wants to bless the people of God. There should be something that's bigger than what you're going to get, that's saying, you know what, I want somebody else to grow in the Lord. The God of all grace. He explains this, verse 3. He says, not as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. The God of all grace. We've seen this in our society, in our churches, and Peter is speaking to a church that's going through. Remember that. He's saying that you can't lead these peoples as lords over them. We're in a day and time, I've seen some churches that the preachers and the deacons yell at folks, and they're lords. They're like little dictators that have been set up, and they've got their thrones and their crowns and all of this stuff, and people are running around bowing down to them, kissing their ring. But I proclaim today that the devil is a lie, that we need to realize, you know what, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the kingdom of heaven. I put my pants on just like you put your pants on, and all of us stink. Any amens in the house? Please understand, not as being lords over those entrusted to you. We need to walk in humility. It's not about big eyes and little you. This is about Jesus that saved us and delivered us and set us free. He said, but if you're going to lead, you got to be examples to the flock. What's happening to the church where we can have leaders that look good on Sunday, but they jacked up the rest of the week? What's happening to the church where we can have folks that are celebrities on TV, but they're sleeping around with the sisters on the front pew? What's happening to the church of God that we're supposed to be examples to the flock, but yet we're falling apart in our lives and the flock is looking the other way? God of all grace. We're in a time of preachers of LA where the ratings are off the charts. And I proclaim you, it is not the heathens that are looking at these shows. It's the house of the Lord. Why? Because there's something that entices us when we see a preacher that's in the pulpit and can deliver it and bring it, but yet there's something about the secret life. We're in a time of reality TV.
Yeah, reality TV says we want insight into people's lives, but the problem is we don't want the people to change because it messes up the ratings. And we look at here not being lawyers, but we've got to be examples to the flock. That means what I tell you, I should be walking it out. I'm not just talking to the deacons, the elders, the pastors, the ministers in the house, but there's some mamas and daddies that need to realize today that in order for your children to follow you, you need to be an example. We're past the day to just do what I tell you to do and not what you see me do. We're past that. If you are saved and sanctified, you trying to tell somebody else to do something and you doing the opposite, there's a problem. Being examples to the flock, the God of all grace. Now look at this. Verse 4, he says, and the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. See, in our leadership in the church, and I believe all of us in some state are leaders in our lives in some capacity, we've got to know that we do this simply because there's a reckoning that's going to come. That glory, as we talked in that 5:1, is going to be revealed through Jesus Christ. You're going to receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Now this is important to note, because some people are just leading and doing things as stated before so they can get their crown here on earth. Yes, they're trying to get all that they can get here on earth, not realizing if they serve the Lord the way they should, that there's another crown that's going to come that will not fade away. It was interesting, the other day I was by my mother-in-law's house and father-in-law's house, and they have these sterling silver that's up on the cabinet, and the amazing thing, because their silver is always shining, but when I go to some other folks' house, their stuff is jacked up. I used that before. It's all pewtered out and gray. But my mother and father-in-law, what they understood is that in order to keep it shining, you got to keep polishing it up. So Brother Warren, he'll go in periodically through the month and he'll make sure that stuff is shined up. But if you leave it to itself, it's going to come to a point that it'll fade away or be messed up. But I'm so glad for those who serve the Lord in spirit and truth. There's a crown that don't have to be shined over and over again. There's a crown that, you know what, will never fade away, all because the glory of God is upon it. That's what we should serve as. That's why we're here today, because the chief shepherd, he's going to appear. I'm excited to be in capacity of a shepherd, a little shepherd per se, but when the chief shepherd comes, I'm going to be on my face just like everybody else. I'm going to know without a shadow of doubt, if it had not been for him on my side. Anybody know the chief shepherd today? See, I wish I could be there to encourage you all the time, but there's many times you're not going to be able to hear me preach, but you're going to be in the midst of your own struggle on your job. You're going to be in the midst of your own struggle with your family relationship, but you can call on the chief shepherd at any time. You don't have to push a play button. You don't have to go to the internet, but we're talking about wireless communication. Anybody know that you can call on the chief shepherd and he'll show up just in the nick of time? The God of all grace. You'll receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. But he comes to verse 5. He includes the elders in the church, those who are supposed to be mature, walk in the Lord. But he says, likewise, ye younger people. Any younger folks in the house? You can wave your hand. I just want to see it. This is for you. This is for you. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. The God of all grace. Now, this is important. We're missing out. What's wrong with the church? What's wrong with the family? We've got people that don't know how to submit to their elders. I put before you is because there's been a lack of respect for people. There's been a lack of respect for the elders. You remember when doors used to be open, when the mothers of the church were lifted up? You remember when you could go to a mother of the church and ask for prayer and you knew she would pray for you, or the father of the church? But now everybody thinks they're on the same level per se. We got young folks that know everything at 5 years old. We got people that at 14 using the internet and they feel like they know what life is all about. We got folks falling in love and lust, and they think they're going to be with that person their whole life and don't even know he ain't got no job, can't provide, and jacked up in the mind. We got folks that are going through, but young folk, submit yourselves to your elders. It's not because we're so smart, but we've been through something. We've been through the fire and the flood. We had to learn some stuff by some hard hits on our head. Any amen? Some beatings on our backside. We just trying to save you. A little stress in your life. I'm talking about the God of all grace. Likewise, younger people, submit yourself to your elder. That means that sometimes, young people, you're going to want to do some stuff, but grandma's going to tell you don't do it that way. Y'all better hear me. I'm trying to save you from stuff. There's going to be sometimes you're going to like a young man or a young woman, but mama or daddy going to say something ain't right. And you in love. But mama and daddy say, I ain't hoodwinked by this guy. I ain't hoodwinked by this girl. Because I know cousin. I know their cousin. And I know how they turned out. And they ain't got the same upbringing that you got. You better listen to them. Submit. Submit yourselves to your elders. But he puts this, yes, all of you be submissive one to another and be clothed in humility. That means we're working together. God has put a hierarchy in the church. He's put those that have gone through elders, he said, but we all got to be submissive because we all don't know it. Don't you know that a child can speak a powerful word in our lives to correct us? So we've always got to be willing to hear. And he says we've got to be clothed in that humility. This is a powerful verse. It actually comes from Proverbs 3:34 and James 4:6. Combined, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Now, this is awesome. I'm a little ashamed to tell you this, but I'm going to put it out there. In one of my vehicles one time, actually it was several times, I put the parking brake on. I did this because I thought it was a good tactic to do. It was there. I never used it before, so I pulled that thing up and pressed it down and left the car. Well, little unbeknownst to me, the next day I came out and I needed to go somewhere as usual, and I started out in the vehicle, but I forgot to take the brake off. But please don't try this, but if you press the gas enough, even with the brake on, it'll still move. It was amazing. I got out on the road and everything, and it was in my mind, something is wrong. The car is not moving the way it used to move. It seems like something is pulling me back. What was happening was the brake was resisting my momentum forward. This is what the scripture is saying here. When you are proud in yourself, you think you got it all together, and you got your nose stuck up and your chest out because you feel like that you all of that in a bag of chips. It says God resists the proud. It doesn't say that he'll stop you, but he said he'll put the brakes on you real lightly. So everything that you try to do, there's a resistance that's going on. There's smoke that's going on. It's breaking you down, and eventually you're going to fall apart. But the flip side, he gives grace to the humble. That means that if you're walking in humility, he's going to lubricate stuff. Anybody know what lubrication does? Without lubrication, it squeaks. But when God puts the lubrications on, there's going to be some times in your life, you're like, what's going on? I feel like I'm going downhill. It's because you're walking in humility. God said, it looks like it's level, but I turned it downhill. Anybody ever been to those places where it looked like you were going uphill, but it just messed with how we were looking at it with the mountains? But in essence, we were going downhill. God is saying, because I'm the God of all grace, when you walk in humility, I'm going to open up some doors that you didn't even touch. I'm not talking about the little infrared eye, but I'm talking about when I touch it before you even get there. And you're going to find out that my power and my anointing is more than you can even understand. I didn't come to preach on this term, but there ought to be a few folks in the house to say, God, thank you that you're the God of all grace. I thank you, God, that you've empowered me to do a lot of stuff that I couldn't dare do. I thank you, God, for putting me in a job that I couldn't get on my shelf. I thank you, God, for taking me out of the hospital. The doctor couldn't do anything else for me. Surgery after surgery. But look at me now. God resists the proud, but gives grace. The God of all grace. Look at this. So they're going through, they're understanding leaders, the elders are understanding submission, the young people have a word. And then he gives verse 6, he says, therefore, yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. This is very important. I'm learning in my life. You can choose to humble yourself or to be humble. Tell me. God is such a gracious God. He's such a loving God. And he'll walk with you and walk with you and walk with you and walk with you. But eventually, if you keep walking to yourself, your time is going to run out. Look at this. Therefore, humble yourself. If you do that, that's the progression we do. If we walk in humility under the mighty hand of God, when we realize in our life, when we're walking, that God's hand is over us. Man, wouldn't that change our perspective as we go through the week, that every time we go through our struggles, that God's hand is right there? But wouldn't that change the time that you complain about your boss and your manager when stuff ain't done right and you boil it on the inside, that you realize that God's hand is upon you? Maybe that would have helped Flanagan before he went in and shot those two folks, and because he said it was boiling on the inside, and the third person that actually recovered from that. Maybe it would help so many people that find themselves in kind of suicide attempt if they would realize that in every situation where you feel like you're losing, that God hand got you. I'm telling you, that blesses you to know, even though that you can't see him, that his hand is right over you. And notice, as we submit ourselves to God, that mighty hand, that he's going to exalt you in due time. Now, this is not a saying that it's just eventually going to happen, but actually in the Greek is saying due time is on the way, and it has a specific address, it has a specific calendar event, and it has a specific time. Even though God hasn't told us when due time is already on the calendar. Please hear me today. If God revealed to you the exact day that you were going to come out what you came out, you'd be able to shout a little bit better today. But I want to come to talk to you about faith today. I give you a word that through the scripture today, that your deliverance is already in due time. It's already on the calendar. God already has the time. You just got to trust that it's on the way. If we got some saints that can walk like that, I'm talking about the God of all grace, then we can shout even when it doesn't seem like we should shout. Then we can lift up our hands even when everybody else said, don't lift up your hand. Why? Because in due time. God is saying, if we humble ourselves, the picture of that is when we get down before God in due time, that calendar event time, that exact time, God is going to lift you up. There ought to be some shouts to say, I've been in due time. I know what due time is. Due time is just not for one thing in your life. But some of you walking in due time now. You know, they said you'd never be anybody. You'd never make it. You had a record. You were failing. But look what God did in due time. Look what he did in due time. And they said you'd never get married. You never amount to anything. Your marriage wouldn't make it. But in due time, look at you. Look at you. The doctors walked away from you and said, you're not going to come out of this. But due time came in your way. You got lupus in your life, and they said you only live a certain amount of time, but you passed that, so you're in due time today. You've been looking for a church, but God moved you from here to there, came from New York and Ohio, and in due time, just coming down the road, God said, stop by there in due time. The God of all grace. Okay. Verse 7. We got a few more verses. Now, this is powerful. Remember the context. The people are going through, they're struggling, they're losing stuff. They're seeing their loved ones die. He said, humble yourselves. God's going to take care of it. Verse 7, he says, cast all your care upon him, that chief shepherd, for he cares for you. This is awesome because if you're not going through, wait a little bit. If everything is in your life is going well, you don't have a care in the world, just live a little bit. I'm not a prophet of doom today. I'm just telling you it's life. Job said, you know what? A man's life is short and it's full of trouble. And in the same respect, he says, when you have cares in your life, when you're struggling with stuff, you ever just struggle with yourself? Yeah, everything going well in your life, but you're emotionally struggling about life and who I am and your calling. Maybe you've been overwhelmed by society, overwhelmed by school, overwhelmed by studies, overwhelmed by just living. Amen's in the house. You get up in the morning and all of a sudden there's a pain in your shoulder. You're like, where did that come? You become overwhelmed before. You used to could just run around like nobody's business without losing breath, but now you can barely get from the car to the front door. Anybody just been overwhelmed? You're looking at yourself. Your skin used to be so subtle and shiny. Now you got to put all of a lay on it and you got to cover up all the spots. I'm talking all your kids. Because he cares for you. This is good to know. In a society that's falling apart at the seams, where people are prolificating that they can solve this and solve that and can't solve anything because they can't keep their own life in place, it's good to know that I have a God that said, cast all your care. Casting in the Greek is the same picture as when you go fishing. I'll be honest, I don't like fishing that much. I've been out deep sea fishing and it scarred me for the rest of my life. But I do know what casting is. Casting means that you take that rod and you put whatever you're going to put on it. You pull it back and you throw. You're casting. You're casting it out. You cast it out as far as you want to in the area that you're going to get a bite. And the same respect, God is saying, whatever cares you have, throw it on out. Throw it on out, but don't throw it out in just a haphazard way. I want you to cast it to me. That means, tell me, sometimes you're going to have to do this in the midst of your situation. You're going to have to cast it up in the air. Your enemy going to think you lost your mind because when they don't know. I talked about this. They don't know you on medication. They don't understand. They don't understand what's in your pocketbook. They don't know. They don't know that you know how to fight. You may be a girl, but you can let it down. You take your heels off. They don't understand that there's a deep, dark side of you. If it had not been for the Lord on your side, but every now and then you just like, what you doing? I'm just casting. Just leave me alone. I'm casting it on him because I know he cares for me. Cuz, look at this. Just a few more verses, a few more. He cares for you. Then he says, be sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Now this is awesome. Those of you that have had issues with sobriety, you understand this. When you were drunk, you were not sober. But what your friends would tell you, need to sober up. And I'm not experiencing this, but some of y'all know this a little bit better. But when you sober up, it means you get out of your inebriated state and you're calm and you realize the choices that you're making. He's telling the Peter, he said, some of you have been intoxicated because the enemy has come against you so much and you're frazzled in your mind, but you need to calm it down. Some of you are not sober because the doctor has given you a prognosis and it's messing with you. It's messing with your mind and your heart, but I'm telling you, you need to be sober. Some of you can't think because you fell out with such and such this morning. You still haven't recovered from the jacked up stuff that happened last week. But he said, be sober, and now you got to be vigilant. Now you got to focus in and realize it's really not about you, it's bigger than you, because your adversary, the devil, is walking about and he's like a roaring lion and he's seeking who he may devour. Please note today, the devil is after you. If you are a saint and you're called of the Lord, he's on your track. Yes, he is. He'll come with little sayings. He'll come with little thought patterns. You never had something to pop in your mind and you weren't even thinking like that. That was the devil. He was just walking about. He just doesn't want to kiss you. He wants to devour you. He wants to eat you up. He wants your marriage to fall apart. He wants your church to split. He wants everything in your life to be lost. He wants you to come to the point of saying, I give up and I can't do anything. Devil, I'll fall you. But please understand verse 9. It said, resist him. Be steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world, the God of all grace. Peter's saying, come on, y'all got to get it together. The devil is doing his job. So you got to know, as you're sober and you're vigilant, you got to come to this point. You already know that he's going to come. Look at our society. He's coming left and right. You don't have to wonder if the enemy's going to come at you. You don't have to wonder if you're going to be tempted. It's going to come. Some of you got pressures on your mind right now, pressures against your body right now. You've been thinking about doing stuff, but it says resist the devil. Remember, it's the same picture that I used with the brakes on my car, that resistance can be used in the same way. It means even when the devil is pushing me, I got to put the brakes on. Oh, yes, 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 yes. Remember, I used that semblance. The problem, the reason I was able to move the car, because I didn't pull it up tight enough. If I had pulled the brake up tight enough, it would have locked in my brake. And even if I put on the gas, it wouldn't have moved. But I didn't pull it up all the way. Therefore, I could still progress with resistance. But please understand, when you know the devil is coming at you, you got to pull up the brakes on some stuff. You know you've been delivered from cursing, but every now and then a curse will come up on the inside. But you need to pull up the brakes real big and say, no, I'm not going back there anymore. You know you used to lose it every now and then, but now you've been walking with the Lord a little bit. Every now and then the enemy will come by, but please understand, just pull up the brakes and say, I am the redeemed, I am the delivered, I know the God of all grace. I've got to be steadfast in the faith. Steadfast means foundational. It means that no matter what comes, that I'm rooted and I'm grounded. I used this before. It's like the Weeble Wobbles, and I'm giving my age at this point. Remember the Weeble Wobbles? Very important. They had some kind of weight in the bottom of it. I used to like to play with them when I went to other folks. I didn't have many toys that I like, Mama. You know what I'm talking about. But when I used to go over somebody else's house, I would find a Weeble Wobble, and I would just hit the thing. And it was challenging because I was determined to knock the Weeble Wobble down. But what I found out, every time I hit the Weeble Wobble, it would go down, but it would pop right back up. I'm telling you, I'm a little challenging sometimes. I would grab the Weeble Wobble. I would throw it up in the air. It would fall down on the crown of it. But when it got back to its base, it would find itself standing up again. Could that be a message to the house of God today? When we resist the devil, we can be steadfast in the faith. That no matter what the devil brings at us, he can knock on us and we can fall down. But you need to know, devil, I'm going to get back up. And I know, just a couple more verses. I know something Peter said. Don't think that your issues are just your issues. Don't think that you're the only one that's going through. It concerns me. I talk to a lot of folks, and somehow they think that they're going through is, you know what, this ain't never happened to anybody else. Yeah, they talk to you like, you know what, this is God just poured it on me. Nobody else experiences. But Peter said, you got to know other folks going to the same stuff. There's someone that may be sitting right beside you that's going through the same mess you're going through. Yeah, they just ain't revealed it to you. They may have already progressed. They further down the road from you, but you don't understand that. So you say, well, Pastor, if they're going through the same suffering, how can they lift up their hand? Why? Because they're walking by faith and not by sight. And they know what the God of glory can do. That the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. Look at this. Verse 10, 11. We're finished. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered, you can look at all your translations, it come out the same thing. After you have suffered a while, perfect, that picture in Greek is mature, establish, strengthen, and settle. Talking about the God of all grace. I love what Peter uses this. Remember, he's having flashbacks of how God worked in his life. But he's saying the God of all grace, the one who empowers us, the God who has all of the grace, not just a little bit of the grace, but has all of the grace. That means that no matter what I'm going through, God has enough grace to cover me. It means no matter what is presented to me, God's grace is sufficient. He's the God of all grace, and you got to know this. This is for the saved people who are called, those who have been called to his eternal glory, and we got to know how to come by Christ Jesus. There's only one way, the truth and the life, only one door. His name is Christ Jesus. After you have gone through a bit, there's something about suffering, and I've said this, I don't like to go through, I don't like to struggle, but I found out something, when you suffer a while, God can do something. It breaks you down, and some of you, you need to put stuff in that cause you to suffer a little bit. I'm telling you, because if you don't do it, God's going to do it. You got to do some jobs that cause you to suffer a little bit. I'm telling you, you get you a garden or something, and go out there about 11 a.m. and work till about 2 and just suffer a little bit. Get the sweat popping on your head, because when you come back into your air condition after being there all the hours, all of a sudden you say, good God Almighty, I didn't realize how blessed I was, because when you suffer a little bit, now you can understand his glory. He said, I'm going to perfect you. I'm going to mature you. In the suffering, please understand, there's a maturity process that takes place. There's some witness in the house. Because you've gone through the stuff that you're experiencing today, it don't even bother you that much. Why? Because you already know God can bring you out. He's already done it one time. And you say, you know what? If God brought me through that, oh, there ought to be some amens in the house. That's why the writer said, I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know the God of all grace. He's going to perfect you, mature you. He's going to establish you, that foundation. He's going to strengthen you. You mean to tell me when I suffer, God is going to give me strength? Yeah, ask Paul the Apostle. He'll say, I found out. I asked God to move the suffering from my life, the thorn from my life, and God refused. But he said, I found out something when I was weak. I didn't hear amens in the house. Then I began, I'm telling you, there's something about God. He just works in different ways. When we are down and out and don't have much strength in ourselves, aren't you glad God said, I got you? It's the same picture. I remember my kids were small when they were going through and maybe they were struggling with something. It would make me good. I would come over there and I'd be able to pick up my child in my hand and say, I got it. Why? Because I'm bigger. I'm bigger than you. I'm mature than you. I've been establishing this. You can't understand what you're going through right now, but just trust me. Just trust me. Put a little time on it. You'll be able to work the puzzle. It'll be okay. Don't fall apart just because your little phone won't ring. Please understand, life is bigger than just what you're going through. But that's what suffering does for us. When we're going through, we've lost everything. Perfect us, establish us, strengthen you, and now I'm settled. I'm looking for some saints in the house. I don't think I'm that old, but some saints that's been through some stuff. I'm talking about settled saints. You know how it is when you get cornflakes at times. It's all puffed up, but when that stuff settles down, it becomes half the box it was when you started. I need some folks that's not full of air, but some folks that's gone through some stuff. They've gone through the fire, said before, and they've gone through the flood. They've been settled. They're not frazzled by the things of the world. They're not frazzled by folks that are doing stupid stuff on the news. They're not frazzled by that, but they're settled in the Lord, because they know what the word said, that God is coming back soon, that in the last days all kinds of stuff is going to happen. Look at this, verse 11, last verse. It says, to him, talk about the God of all grace, be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. What happens here? Peter, as he's led of the Holy Spirit, he's given his word to a church that's going through, that's under persecution. He encapsulates this, and this is a shout. This is a shout of praise. A doxology comes. He says, my goodness, I'm not finished with the book. I got to give some greetings to some other folks, but let me take a little bit of time to just shout and thank the Lord. There's going to be some times, and I'm not telling you to do it right now, but you got to shout out of order. God has done so much for you, and it builds up on the inside. You've been settled, established. Before you get to the church, you're going to find yourself with doxology. God, I can't walk another step, because I got to praise you right now. I dare you to think about the goodness of the Lord and all that he's done for you. We got too many sophisticated saints that don't realize where God has brought them from there. You can't shout until the praise team sings. You can't shout until the preacher preaches. But I'm looking for some real folks in the house to say, you know what, God has been too good for me. I love the experience of church on the Sunday. I love the experience of coming to the house of the Lord. But let me tell you something, God has just been too good to me. And every now and then when nobody else is around, I gotta think about what God has done for me. To give me the glory and dominion and power forever and ever, amen. Could Peter be thinking back when he saw Jesus beaten all night long? Could he be realizing that he was actually in that place where Jesus had told him, you know what, the devil comes to desire you, to sift you like wheat? Peter was all caught up in himself because he had not learned the art of submission. He had not become an elder yet, but he found out the devil can come and be persuasive. Remember, Peter was messed up in the mind. A young lady came unto him and said, I think you're one of those that were walking with him. But Peter said, no, 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 that's not me. I don't even know the man. Somebody else came up and said, yes, 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 you're one of those that walked with him. You remember when he divided the bread and the fish? You were there. He said, no, 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 I don't even know the man. Somebody else came up. We're talking about the God of all grace. And he said, you know what? You gotta be one of them. Your language betrays you. You even talk like him. You come from the same area he comes from. But aren't you glad for the God of all grace? The scriptures seem to indicate at that very time, Peter looks at Jesus that's suffering and has been beaten all night long. Eye contact is made, and all of a sudden the cry crows. But aren't you glad that even when we go against God, even though we mess up, that the God of all grace keeps on blessing? Aren't you glad that Jesus didn't give up? Aren't you glad he didn't say, Peter, because you denied me, I won't take the nails in my hand? But are there any witnesses in the house? Can I just preach just a little bit today? But aren't you glad that Jesus could have called legions of angels to set him free? But no, he didn't. He said, let the nails be put in my hands and let the nails be put in my feet. They hung them high and they stretched them wide. Does anybody know the God of all grace? He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Anybody know the God of all grace? I'm talking about the God that can perfect you. I'm talking about the God that can establish you. I'm talking about the God that can strengthen you. I'm talking about the God that can settle you. Are there any witnesses in the house? Do you know he died on the cross of Calvary? They put him in the cold tomb. The sun refused to shine. But aren't you glad the story's not over? You know what? I've told this story thousands of times, but it's still good to me. Why? Because I know my deliverance was on the way. Are there any witnesses in the house? You know that he didn't stay there, but something happened on the third day, that early Sunday morning. Maybe that's why we like to get our praise on. There's something that drives the church to gather with one another, and we begin to think about the goodness of the Lord. Why? Because we know that he's going to turn back up again. When the chief shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of glory that does not fade away. I don't know when he's coming back today, but I've decided every time I get the opportunity, I'm going to praise him. I don't know how you praise him. Some of you might lift up your hand, but I'm going to praise him. I don't know how you praise him. Some of you may have tears from your eyes, but I'm going to praise him. I don't know how you praise him, but every now and then my feet will get light. They call me the pogo stick, because when I think about the goodness of Jesus, I'm going to praise him. When the chief shepherd appears, to him be the glory, to him be the honor, to him be the power forever and ever. Can we just have a praise break right here? The God of all grace, if he's done anything for you, I tell you, this unnecessary, a Pentecostal church. But there ought to be somebody to run right now. There ought to be someone to shout right now. The God of all. Come on to your feet. Come on to your feet. Thank you.
proclaim that you're the God of all grace. And we are so happy about it. We're happy about it. We're happy about it. We praise you with our emotion. We give you our spirit, our soul. Even as David danced before you, we give it all to you. We had 10,000 tongues. We couldn't praise you enough. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for breath. Thank you. Thank you. Get close and pray with us.
Come on to the altar.
Our deacons, our intercessors, come on. Salvation, rededication of your life. Christian experience of our letter and covering. If you're here up here, just make sure you just catch one of our elders and say, I'm here. I need you to touch me. Some of you just need to come up here. And you're struggling. You're suffering. You're going through. You are going through. But today you've been blessed. You know the God of all grace knows what you're going through. And he cares. He cares for you. He cares. There's room.
Oh, yes, he does. Thank you.
thank you.
I love you.
God is good.
Love you. I love you.
All the time.
I love you. I need you.
There's healing in the name of Jesus. There's deliverance in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
There is salvation in the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus.
I need you.
He does so much for you. God woke you up early this morning. He allowed you to see a new day. You ought to tell God, thank you. Thank you, God, I was able to put on my own clothes. God, we thank you. Your name. You are worthy to be praised.
I need you.
We realize you didn't have to do it, but you did.
You, Jesus. Gotta
oh God,
have
we
you,
thank
Jesus.
You.
Gotta have
we thank you for that water that you allowed us to drink early this morning. Keep us in your divine care.
I love you, Jesus.
We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We glorify you, Lord. And we magnify your name. Those of you that's still in your pews, press your way down the aisle. We all stand in the need of prayer. We all stand in the need of a blessing.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Just come in the middle of the aisle. Stand in a seat for someone else. I know you have a loved one that's sick.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
I know you have somebody going through behind the prison wall. Make no difference. God is there. If you love the Lord today, just lift your hands and magnify him. Tell him thank you. Tell God thank you. Just keep talking to him as we go in prayer. Just know that the Lord is going to meet you right there. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Blind, but now I see. Eternal God is again that we come. We come to the throne of grace, thanking you for waking us up early this morning, still clothed in our right mind. God, we realize that you didn't have to do it, but you did. Thank you for starting us on another day's journey. It's been hard living down here, but thank you, God, for just stopping by this morning. Thank you, God, for our family. Thank you, God, for we are able to look around our home and find that sea and everything is still intact. Thank you for having mercy. We mercy have been found. Oh God, we teach us how to love one another. Teach us how to talk to one another. Teach one of us, all of us together, to walk hand in hand. Let it start in our heart. Search our heart this morning. Search our mind this morning. Oh God, we need you. We need
glory by your name. We love you this morning.
Jesus,
come on in. Take your seat.
Jesus.
When it's all over. When we can't put on these old clothes. When we can't shake hand in hand. After the battle has been fought. And the victory has been won. We want to hear your welcome voice saying, well done. As you take your seat, when you prepare to take your seat, just know that you're still in the Lord's care. Know that you're not alone. He walks with you. He talks with you. He will let you know that you're his own. It's in the name of Jesus. Let the redeemed say amen. Now come on, give God some praise. Oh, y'all can do better than that. Come on, give God some praise.
My name is Keith Brooks. Most of y'all probably know me as Shannon's husband, but I'm coming to join today on my Christian beliefs. I like to be a member of this church. I was raised up in a church, New Zion Baptist Church, and this reminds me a lot of New Zion. You know, a nice, small, family-oriented, based church, Christian church, you know. I came here my first time, watch night service, and I knew right then that, you know, this was going to be my home from here on out. So here I am.
Brother Deacon Shannon's husband has come forth today. Keith Brooks, coming on his Christian experience. I asked him, is he saved? He loved the Lord. He said, yes, he wants to be a part of Ebenezer Baptist Church. How should he be received? Brother Keith, you know how we do this. We slow it down. We hold tradition as we go through here, simply because we want our elders to speak up. We want them to be a part of this growing relationship. But we want you to speak up also. If you want to get to know Shannon's husband better, Keith, we ask you to come to your feet, those that are members of Ebenezer, and give God a hand clap of praise. Please continue to speak. Closing out, just stand on your feet. All our newcomers at our Newcomers Foundational Truth class, you got certificates on last Sunday. If you didn't, they're up here on front. You may have noticed something over in the right-hand corner. I did not sign those, so please forgive me for that. If you would like me to sign them, I'll be happy to sign. If you want to put my name there, just sign it the way you want to. That'll be fine also, so I give you liberty to do that. But we want you to remember that. Our fasting week, please, please, please. We're kind of kicking it off today. It starts on tomorrow. But our consecration and prayer by interceding for our children that are back in school happens today at 4 o'clock, 4 to 5. And then we're going to have services that are set aside. We'll be here on Monday from 7 to 8. And then we'll be back here on Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And then on Thursday from 7 to 8. And then on Friday, 6 o'clock for our Panic Heart service. So consecration and prayer this week. And I tell you, God is already working it out. He's the God. If you sense His Spirit, you sense His Spirit. I think He is well pleased. Gospel choir, would you give us a closing selection, please? Establish strength.